Hey everybody, welcome back to the channel. Thank you very much for taking your time out. Now, I have been riding the Himalayan 450 and the KTM Adventure 390X. And yeah, for some reasons, I do not know why I lost the audio was not recorded at the GoPro. But then I thought, let me make this video because I have the footages and it makes sense for me to spread the information, you know, whatever I think is appropriate. So let's compare the KTM 390 Adventure X and the Himalayan 452. The reason we are picking up the Adventure X model is because, you know, the price of the Adventure X is 2,83,000, and that's like showroom price. And the Himalayan Honley black color, that's exactly at the same price at 2,83,000, right? So because these motorcycles, they are at exact same price range and they are, you know, targeted for the same set of customers. So let's quickly talk about the engine, because that's the most important thing. Features and stuff, we will talk about them later on. So the engine is that, so in terms of power, yeah, the KTM does have an advantage, because although it's a smaller motor of 373 cc, but then it makes a little bit more power than the Himalayan, and it's like 42.5 bhp, where the Himalayan is 40 bhps. But then the character of both the engines are like days, nights and days apart, right? So the KTM, it likes to be revved, the engine wants to be on the boil all the time, and if you want to literally have fun with that motor, you constantly have to keep ringing the throttle, otherwise, you know, you won't actually enjoy that motor. On the other hand, with the Royal Enfields, the Himalayan's motor is something that it enjoys being, you know, revved gently. It does not like to be revved like all of a sudden. Now, let's say on, if you are in second gear on both the motorcycles, on the Himalayan, you can come down to speeds as low as like 20 kilometers per hour, and the bike will not stutter. There would be no knocking from the engine, you know, even at second gear at 20 kilometers. On the KTM, however, you have to get down to the first gear, because that engine does not sustain higher gears in lower speeds. That is one major problem with the KTM, and that's something which I find a little bit annoying whenever I'm riding my friend's KTM 390 Adventures, especially off the road, because I mean it needs countless downshifting. But the Himalayan is totally opposite. You can be in second or third gear and you can, you know, miss one of the downshifts and you can still go, as long as you're keeping the engine above like 2,500-3,000 rpm, because that's where the torque comes in. And yeah, it's a friendly motor. The KTM, where it gets really engaging and really fun, is on the freeways or during overtakes, right? So the power, the mid-range, as I said, it's toxic, and you open the throttle, the bike just goes like a rocket. That's how lovely the engine responds. Although there are a significant number of vibrations on that engine if you compare it with the Himalayan. But yeah, whenever you are on the highways, let's say you are riding at like 125-130 kilometers per hour, you want to overtake something, you do not have to downshift. You just have to open the throttle. There is still enough juice in the motor that it would take you, you know, easily. You can overtake a couple of vehicles, and like, yeah, that's how lovely that motor is. But yeah, and once it is like above 6,000 rpm, that's when the vibration starts to fade away. But at lower revs, in lower gears, the engine is extremely noisy. And you know, at times, like whenever, say, you took a U-turn, you start from a signal or something, you can actually see the entire front end, it will just shake, it will be nodding, especially the instrument console and the entire headlight assembly, the small windscreen that's there on the KTM, that looks a little bit weird, right? So yeah, on the other hand, the Himalayan, it does not have any such problem. So if you are a very aggressive rider who likes to ride hard like all the time, like a hooligan, the way a KTM should be ridden, yes, you're going to enjoy it. But then for anybody else, like say you are a beginner, or say you want a relaxed motorcycle, you know, which has longer legs, so in that case you will appreciate the Himalayan more than the KTM. Okay, now let's talk about the features from front to rear. So both the bikes, they get LED headlights, LED blinkers, that's standard, and they have a different approach altogether. KTM is more sharp, Royal Enfield is a little bit circular and less angular, and the wheel size is totally different. The KTM has 19-inch and it has cast alloy wheels, so you do run tubeless wheels, tubeless tires, and that comes with some peace of mind. And Himalayan definitely has that advantage of running cross the spoke wheels, the Y-spoke wheels. However, it's not that the KTM's cast alloy wheels are any bad. I have not heard any instance wherein somebody has, you know, complained that he has actually broken or cracked the wheel, you know, even if it is cast wheel. So it's, both the motorcycles are equally reliable, at least when it comes to the, you know, rims and the wheels. Right now, the suspension duties on KTM, that is from WP, it is an extremely stiff unit, and if you are riding solo on cemented roads or broken roads, everything is going to be transferred from the road via the suspension to your back. That's how stiff the suspension is. So that is one downside. But when you are cornering hard, when you're riding aggressive, the suspension's stiffness, that gives a lot of confidence. So there's a pro and there's a con. On the Himalayan, on the other hand, that bike just inspires you to go over any bad road, any speed breaker, any pothole, whatever it is, it encourages you to go fast, and because the suspension will just absorb everything that the roads have to throw at it, right? And so that is one advantage. The disadvantage is that when you are turning or you're in corners or in ghat roads where you have to brake, all of a sudden the dive in the front suspension is a lot, and that may steal some confidence away from newer riders. Experienced riders will not have a problem, but newer riders, they do feel, they will feel that dive and they will feel a little bit uncomfortable. And then the switch gear, I am really shocked, I'm really surprised that KTM is actually giving such horrible plastic quality. At least the switches, they're like, it feels like some kid has taken a small hacksaw blade and has cut the switches. It looks, it's finished very bad. And yeah, this is something that KTM needs to fix. The Royal Enfield, on the other hand, surprisingly, it feels a lot more premium. The switches are designed very well. There's a nice tactile feel to them, and finishing is extremely good. It's quite high quality compared to the KTM, right? And instrument console, yeah, let's not even talk about it, because the X version does not get the color TFT dash off the top of the line model. So, what information that you get, it's very basic. It will show you whatever you want to see, but nothing fancy. The Himalayan, on the other hand, yeah, as I said, let's not even talk about it. It's like head and shoulders above. It's like the most gorgeous display ever on any production motorcycle, as according to me, that's what I would say. Right, and then moving further back, the fuel tank, Himalayan has a bigger fuel tank. 17 liters, KTM has 14 liters, so you get more, how you can cover more distance on the Himalayan. The seat height is not as tall as the KTM, so shorter riders, even who are like 5'5", 5'6", or even 5'7", they will have a good time on the Himalayan, but the KTM is punishing. If you are anyone below 5 feet 8 inches, you are going to have a tough time. Either you have to be, an experienced rider, somebody who is comfortable with taller seats, or you better look somewhere else, or you have to be someone really tall. So that is one advantage of the Himalayan here as well. The Himalayan is a lot more comfortable, and then Himalayan also comes with a luggage rack system, so you can mount your top box with a base plate. The KTM does not have anything of that sort. And the rear part, that looks a lot more cleaner on the Himalayan because it does not have the tail light assembly, and the tail lamp is integrated into the turn signals. The exhaust is quite similar on both the motorcycles. They are like quite slim and small. Nothing fancy going on over there. That's about all the features and engine and everything. Now, if I were to buy, which one would I buy? So, I would pick the Himalayan any given day because it has that added versatility with the wire spoke wheels and bigger front, and then the plastic quality and everything is much better on that. I love that engine because it generates more torque, and I am not a big fan of frequent downshifts and upshifts. So again, Himalayan suits my riding style more. But as I said, if you are an aggressive rider who's like constantly on the boil, constantly pumped up with adrenaline rush, you can look at the KTM. There is no problem with that. But yeah, hopefully KTM should fix all these niggles, and I believe that by mid of 2024 or by towards the end of 24, they should bring the updated 390 Adventure with the Gen 3 Duke's engine and the new platform. And yeah, hopefully by then all the issues that the KTM engine is already having, or the 390 Adventure is having, those will be ironed out. So yeah, that's about my analysis. I hope that you guys agree, and in case if you disagree, do let me know in the comments. I'll see you guys again in another video. Until then, stay safe, ride safe, and God bless you all, my dear friends. Have a really good time. Bye-bye.